Hey guys, what is up? Welcome to another The Batman video. Today we're doing another installment in the Batman discussion series. I believe this is the first installment in that series post the DC Fandom main trailer for The Batman. If you haven't seen it already, I did do a whole breakdown for the hidden DC Fandom panel. And I say hidden because it wasn't actually a part of the main DC Fandom that you probably experienced. So we had Matt Reeves, Zoe Kravitz, Pattinson, get into details that we weren't shown at DC Fandom because it was a part of a Chinese panel. Just thought I would chuck that out there in case none of you had seen it. It's very fascinating. You get some great nuggets of information from the stars of the movie themselves. I'm still surprised they didn't put that in the main DC Fandom event, but today we also have some news to break down. I want to cover a few things before we get into the Q&A kind of discussion theory part. So by all means, if you want to skip the news segment of this video, go ahead to the questions because a lot of you have submitted a shit ton of questions, so we've got a lot to get into. But before I blabber too much more, let's get into the news. And I say news, some of you may have heard of this, some of you may not have, and go over that and then get into the actual discussion part of this as always. And I do encourage you as always to put your questions down in the comment section of this video as well. I'm always collecting them, so if you have any questions pertaining to the main trailer that we got at DC Fandom in October and you want me to answer them in one of these videos coming in the future, well, you know what to do. But let's start with the actual synopsis of the movie, because I haven't actually been over that yet, and probably a few of you have heard this by now. We also have some new promo art, which I just wanted to feature because some of it looks really, really awesome. So the latest synopsis of the movie goes as follows. The Batman is an edgy, action-packed thriller that depicts Batman in his early years, struggling to balance rage with righteousness as he investigates a disturbing mystery that has terrorized Gotham. Robert Pattinson delivers a raw, intense portrayal of Batman as a disillusioned, desperate vigilante awakened by the realization that the anger consuming him makes him no better than the ruthless serial killer he's hunting. Now, I just thought that was a cool little update to chuck to you guys. Already, some people are like, oh my god, they described it as edgy. Well, just no, don't be one of those people. Edgy, as a lot of you are probably aware, that word has kind of taken a new meaning on the internet. The way they're using edgy here is actually as in like the intended meaning. It's not meant to mean, oh, the Batman's an edgy movie. Not in that way, but as in like literally the Batman is an edgy action-packed thriller that depicts Batman in his early years. You see what they're really going for there. But also, you know, it just delves into some more of what we already know, because this portrayal of Batman is disillusioned. In, you know, 1 year, 6 months into his life, he's a desperate vigilante, and at some point he's going to be awakened in this movie by the realization that the anger consuming him is really not going to make him too much better than, you know, the serial killer he's after. Now, I mean, yes and no, because it's not like he is killing people like the Riddler, but as a lot of you already know through our previous discussions, Batman, as I've already said, is going to walk that line a couple of times. There's going to be certain pressures in this movie that really push Bruce to walk the line of the no kill rule, and we know that's coming anyway for all the motivations and inspirations for this movie. So you get what they're going with there with the synopsis, and you know, I'm just looking forward to this Batman grow as a character, because in this movie he's going to be insanely Batman, but he's also going to be kind of far away from the very tempered Batman who's quite experienced. A very angry Batman. He's always going to be angry, but you see where I'm going with this. A few years down the line, he will be a bit more adjusted. There will be a bit more equilibrium, if you will, to this Batman, which is funny to say because he's a guy who dresses up as a bat who beats people up at night, but as close to an equilibrium as what Bruce can achieve. At the moment, though, there is no equilibrium. It's just all poured towards rage and his criminological experiment that he isn't really getting the results that he wants. And now it's time to get on to your questions coming out of the main trailer for DC Fandom, because yeah, we've got a lot more to tackle now than just obviously the DC Fandom trailer that we got last year. There's a lot more context now, a lot more speculation, a lot more theories that we can craft together. And as always, I've already taken a bunch of screenshots, and what some of what you're saying has already got my little bat senses tingling, so to speak. But first of all, I need to feature the question that I know a lot of you are asking me, and if I didn't answer it, first of all, I would still be asked about it even if I answered it later in this video. So this is from Moon saying, "Hey Boba, big fan of the channel and series. Thank you very much, Moon. Really appreciate that. Barry Keoghan has been rumored to be playing Joker. What are your thoughts? It's quite out of left field, but I'm all for it." Now, this comes from another, basically, I believe this, whether it's a Twitter page, an Instagram page, I think they are known to be basically a page to follow for spreading tips that they get, just putting it out there kind of thing. And since then, basically, somebody has given them the tip of, "I have really locked down information that probably will send the internet in a swirl. It's 100% true. Barry Keoghan will be playing the Joker on the new Batman. You're welcome. Exclusive info." And since then, people were like, "Oh, you know, is this the case?" Because Barry Keoghan, as a lot of you may be aware, if you're not already, but a lot of you are, but just for those who may be new to this Batman fandom, so to speak, is that people have been wondering what Barry Keoghan's role has been for the longest time. Now, Barry Keoghan isn't the world's biggest actor right now, but I'm telling you, and this should go without saying, he is on the rise. I mean, obviously he's in the Eternals, he's been in quite a few big movies, but his career is skyrocketing right now. Just you watch over the next few years. I don't even need to explain, and if you don't believe me, just you wait until you see. So when he was cast as a police officer or a cop named Stanley Merkel, people were like, you know, I think he's going to be Mad Hatter. He's even had a photo, I believe, in a subway or a train station with a little hat on the wall, and he stood under it, which, you know, fed people to believe the speculation of, oh, he's playing Mad Hatter secretly. So this is where things get interesting, because he is too big of a role for people to have believed, and have even believed, to be just playing Stanley Merkel or whatever, right? So people have been speculating that his character has been a cover for quite some time in the movie. Like, this isn't new news. It's even been speculated before that he could even be the Joker, but obviously with the evidence, you know, it's not really evidence, it's more circumstantial, and people adding it into their theory of the Mad Hatter top hat photo, people are like, oh, he's probably playing like a secret bent cop who's really the Mad Hatter, and this is his origin. Now, here's my take on this. I have heard quite a while ago that indeed, now this is I don't want to sound like I'm elitist, rumory, saucy or anything, because I'm only saying what people have already been saying for a while. I have heard from people I very much so trust that yes, Stanley Merkel is indeed a cover role for Barry Keoghan. And then you hear stuff like this come out. Now, I'm not saying he is playing Joker, I'm not saying that he isn't playing Joker, but I am very, 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 very confident that he isn't Stanley Merkel. Make of it what you will. If you think he's going to be the Mad Hatter, make of it what you will. If you think he's gonna be freaking Professor Pig, for all I know. Yes, I know, before people say it, I don't know who this viewer anon person is, but they're giving their opinion about, oh, how, you know, don't believe this or something, or maybe then you shouldn't believe this, then 99.7% sure that that might not be the case. All I'm going to say is, I have heard that it's just a cover role. Now, I can't tell you he is the Joker, I can't tell you he is the Mad Hatter, but what I will say is, my opinions on him being the Joker is that, oh yeah, he is more than capable for this vision of a Reeves Joker in this universe, and what they could be doing with him. Now, as for Mad Hatter, yeah, I could see that as well. And before people freak out, as for like Joker in this movie, or Joker again, oh, Joker, I get where people are coming from with that, but if Joker is in this movie, what people need to understand is he's not going to be the threat. He's not going to pertain to the plot necessarily in a huge way. Depends what you believe there. The reason why I said that is because people believe that he could with the drops and stuff. What I'm trying to get down to is, you know, there's fans, even big Joker fans, saying, yeah, but not another Joker. They're expressing concern of, you know, oh, really, Joker? Well, you know, can't we have a movie? It's more of the sense that if this is true and Barry Keoghan is the Joker, the way you should look at it is that it is sequel tease. It will be a kind of scene that maybe you've already heard rumors. I've even covered this before. There's been rumors out there, as I aforementioned, with possibly a Joker scene, but it's kind of more world building in the sense that it would be a tease that could be setting up him in the future. Not that the Joker is going to be injected into this plot and overshadowing and taking the thunder and crown from Riddler's movie. It's not like that. It's one of those like potential jaw-dropping scenes where it's like, holy crap, that's Batman's going to see who I think he might be. Oh my god, oh my god, like that kind of thing. And then maybe the movie ends, could be a post-credit scene. That's the vibe. And to me, like, that doesn't sound alienating to me. Like, it just doesn't. Like, this would still be a movie about the Riddler and Batman and everything else, and that Joker scene will be nothing but, I don't know, a bit of candy for you to get excited for the future of Matt Reeves' The Batman trilogy. That's the expectation you should go in with. Nothing absolutely mind-blowing other than the absolutely, I'm sure, to be engrossing scene of Batman visiting Joker. I think any fan would enjoy that. But the question is it Barry Keoghan? You know, that is the question. Or the question is as well, is that scene that people are talking about even real? But yeah, those are my main thoughts on it with regards to Barry Keoghan. Like, you know, my view on that is just like, people can have their decrees on whether a certain actor will be good for the Joker or not, but I always advise, look at what people said about Heath, look at what people said about various other people who have been cast, look at what people said about Pattinson being cast as Batman. So whatever opinion even you may give on Barry Keoghan or whoever for the Joker, you don't know until you know. You don't know until you see the performance. Now, sometimes I would say, yeah, I don't know about that casting for a certain actor in a certain character, right? But when it comes to the Joker, I don't know if you can do that, because truly that requires such a transformative performance of an actor that, even as I mentioned, it's just such a prime example. People really didn't think that teenage heartthrob Heath Ledger could do that, but he did. So same thing applies to whether you freaking hate this or love this potential casting or cover casting for the Joker, as in Barry Keoghan. Trust me, don't get your mind in the state of, oh, he couldn't play the Joker. It's truly that situation where you probably will have to see it to believe it, and then you'll be like, oh my god. Because of what I've just said, with those same judgments many people have had about previous Batman and Joker castings, it quite often subverts expectations. And not only that, do you really think Matt Reeves will cast an actor for someone like the Joker that would be distasteful to the audience? I don't think so. I really don't think so. So whether it's Barry Keoghan or not, well, we're just gonna have to wait and see. But what I will say is, Barry Keoghan cast as Stanley Merkel, yeah, maybe people shouldn't believe that one. But that doesn't mean he's Joker. It could just mean he's good old Billy Bob from the Narrows selling hot dogs on the side of the street corner. So with those thoughts out the way, let's get on to the actual, I guess, second question from Adam Kova, saying, love your videos, man. Appreciate the time and effort. Thank you very much, Adam. Excuse me there. Just a little thought I had watching this trailer a couple times now. Could the Riddler have left a clue for the Batman in his latte by making the question mark in the foam? Something the police missed? I don't know. Probably a long shot, as it's hard to imagine Batman walking into a cafe and asking guys at the counter, are you going to finish this? So just to entertain this, I don't blame you, trust me, because it is the Riddler after all. I do believe that that is just latte art. Some people viewed it as cheesy. I thought it was a very Riddler thing to do. Why not? If he's intentionally, you know, waiting to get caught by the police, you may as well have a little bit of fun in your latte art, right? But I do, you know, I'd be silly to say that, who knows, maybe he dropped something in there, like a key. I don't know. Like, trust me, like, I'm not saying that's the case. I'm just saying that is totally possible, like, just to entertain your idea of if there is something more to that. Maybe Bruce could go in there, empty the cup, and there's something in that that leads him to the gates of Gotham's orphanage, as we've seen him and Gordon try and break into some of the B-roll footage. That is just random ass speculation from the top of my head. My money is on that it is just a question mark, nothing really more to it. But of course, yeah, you can't really discount the fact that if they emptied that, there could be some little clue in there. But I really don't necessarily think so. That it truly is just Riddler being a bit Riddlery. Grizzly Fear? Fear? I don't know. How did Alfred get that scar on his face? I think I've spoken about this before, because some people think that little scar by his eyebrow is like newish. I don't think it is. I honestly think that's like probably his scar from his service, his SASE type days. Don't forget, Alfred, especially in this iteration, is that very hands-on Alfred, special forces Alfred, the type to possibly even help Bruce with his training Alfred. Yes, of course, you could argue maybe it is an encounter he's had. Maybe if they want to go Batman Earth 1 type vibes, maybe him and Alfred have had a bit of fisticuffs with each other. Who knows? But to me, it looks like a bit of an old scar that Alfred probably got in his days of military-type service. Grizzly asks again, though, and I thought I would include this because a lot of people were asking me about it. But big fan of your videos, been watching ever since I watched the Batman teaser trailer. Thank you very much, dude. And my question is, how did Batman get all of that mud on the Batsuit? So initially, I thought that could have been like the blast kind of, you know, that Gil Coulson, he blows up and Batman gets knocked back. But it doesn't really, it's not really sooty. I mean, some of it looks like that, but mostly it looks like a bit of muddy-esque stuff over him. So I'm a bit in between, because it does look like some rubbly-esque stuff and a sheet of dust from explosion could have gone over him. But it is probably more likely it's connected to the scene of where the Batman lights up that flare and leads a lot of people out from that flooded-looking place that I believe we've got quite a few more questions about later on in the video. Those are my best bets because the armor itself looks pretty intact. It just looks filthy. So this next question from Shavishta, I hope I didn't butcher that. Why don't they ever show the Riddler's face in the trailer? It's in the reflection, but never shown completely. So this one's an interesting one because I do believe the Riddler's face is truly just going to be Paul Dano. We can kind of make out enough of his face to assume that he really does just look like Paul Dano, except, you know, just with his glasses on and the haircut that he's got when we see him get arrested. And as you just said, what we can make out, most of his face, or at least half of it, with the glasses up, in that reflection of the Arkham State Hospital scene and where Batman goes to visit him. However, my best guess is to why they're keeping that ambiguous. Even without much being truly surprising about his face is just because why not? He's the main villain. In a Zodiac Killer, very inspired way, they kind of want his identity. Even though we all know what Paul Dano looks like, it is probably truly what I was just about to say, and how since Reeves is inspired by the Zodiac Killer for the Riddler's concept in design, with the kind of, you know, baggy looking face, the glasses over it, the Zodiac Killer symbol being like a crosshair, except with this alteration and concept there being the Riddler question mark in it, you're not really meant to properly know what that serial killer looks like, even if they look pretty normal underneath. So with that in mind, you know, I don't think it would be like an underwhelming reveal. Maybe to some they might be expecting more, because when they see it is just Paul Dano's face, they might be like, oh, so why hide him? It is probably just for suspense. Like, why not? Why show the identity and look of, I think it comes across a bit more intimidating and fearful when you show the Riddler's Zodiac look with his mask intact, rather than just showing the man behind the mask. We will get that intimacy of scene when, for example, Batman goes to visit him in Arkham State Hospital. That will be incredible. And I think it's also in the sense of a Seven inspired way. For example, Kevin Spacey, you know, we saw him very much so talking, and we saw his face towards the end of that movie. However, all the way up until then, you didn't really see him. There were a couple of clues, of course, like when he took the photograph, but you see what I'm going for here. They could have shown the face. Why not, you know? But it just, it adds this eeriness. It adds this eeriness when dealing with a crime thrillery serial killer investigation like this, where you keep that identity a little bit intact, you know, until you've seen the live stream of his face and stuff, and all of that's out the way. Then, when they're ready to put, like, kind of reveal their hand, they'll show you the face and expressions of Paul Dano, of which, when we do see those, I'm very confident they will be chilling. I think it will be probably in line with the Zodiac Killer as well, with how, in a very psychopathic, kind of sociopathic way, the kind of expressions and tone of voice that he has. I'm a bit of a serial killer nerd with stuff like this, you know, of accounts of the 911 operator. You had the Zodiac Killer ring them up, telling them where the bodies were. Or, you know, this woman on the phone saying, I just killed this person, blah, blah, blah. But when he spoke the whole time, it was with such a neutrality of tone. And, like, when he said goodbye, he was like, goodbye. Do you know what I mean? That's creepy. But I shit you not, like, that's exactly how the Zodiac Killer sounded, reporting his own, like, owning up and boasting to his own murder. So when we hear Riddler in the trailer, I do feel like Matt probably gave Paul Dano the direction to have a very not emotive voice. It's like in the trailer where he says, I've been trying to reach you. There's very little kind of expression there. But when there is, it's just so eerie. So all of that folding into one, it's like, why not keep that eeriness? It's nothing really more than that. And that's my opinion anyway. So SM4 Carnage, I hope, says, I theorize that Bruce is always Batman in this film and only shows himself as Bruce because he has to, and even then remains with an introverted personality. I believe he wears the sunglasses in the trailer because his eyes are not used to the daylight, but by the end, he will realize Bruce's worth, cleans himself up and cuts his hair, therefore creating the Bruce facade persona. So yes and no, but in the right direction, in my opinion. So yeah, this all builds upon the theory that, you know, I can't remember the user, I wish I could, but on this channel for some time, and you might know this already if you've been following this series, is that a lot of us have been speculating and building upon with each installment of this series that Bruce truly, and this really does line up, ever since coming back from his training, excuse the Discord noise, has gone full on Batman mode. So like, honestly, doesn't really care too much about Wayne Enterprises. He does not go out as Bruce Wayne up until the point where he feels kind of forced to. For example, the cathedral scene, it might be one of the scenes or first times Bruce Wayne has been seen publicly going out in Gotham, etc, etc. He's just gone full on Batman, but throughout the trilogy, he will learn that he can't just be Batman. He needs to kind of open up a little bit more, etc, etc. And from what we've heard through some rumors, like Andy Serkis's Alfred tries to encourage Bruce to attend some board meetings at Wayne Manor. He's just like, nope, I don't care. I don't care what happens to me. I'm just doing this. So it's more that kind of thing. So with what you're saying here, I believe he wears sunglasses in the trailer because his eyes are not used to the daylight. I truly believe that. This leads more into the theory of he only goes out at night. He is Batman. There is no duality right now. He is Batman. Hence, though, with what I've been saying, ego, all of these influences making Bruce realize in this movie what he is doing, albeit a crusade that he will continue for many, many, many years to come, is not the exact formula that he should follow for years and years to come. So that will be altered. He will learn to let out his Bruce side a bit more and how that's important. He will learn to peel back the rage a bit, knowing that is very important. As for like cleaning himself and cutting his hair, that could be a symbolic thing. I don't think it is too emo-y like people say. Like, I think he looks cool, and there's been plenty of comic books with that length of hair, like similar to my length right now. Am I emo? No, but you get what I'm saying. But yes, it would be a way for him to symbolically, I suppose, like, yeah, maybe short back and sides Bruce kind of thing, and maybe he attends a meeting at the end with Alfred. He smiles, but obviously, you know, it doesn't mean that he's not being Batman. But yeah, that's a cool idea. But more or less, this all falls and follows suit with this probably very likely being true about Bruce Wayne, Robert Pattinson's Batman in this movie, being a workaholic Batman. Then, and only from here on out in this movie, probably at the end and into the second and third, he will learn the importance of really building that duality. So next up from Zach Briggs, do you think we will ever get a suit-up scene of Batman, including the application of the eye makeup? So this one's quite straightforward for me to answer. I just think it would be a missed opportunity if we didn't, because I really like with what Reeves has done already through showing that Batman applies this, and when you take off the cowl, like every other superhero show or movie, the magic guy liner eye panda makeup just disappears. Now, that is probably because of a couple of reasons, with how the Batman is doing it a bit more tasteful, for example, like Arrow has done with Stephen Amell's Oliver Queen. Now, don't get me wrong, if you took off his eye thing, you would realize that he had the big circle things, which is why, realistically, movie productions always just had it magically disappear, but earlier on in the seasons, it was more of a greasy kind of paint. Now, same thing with Pattinson. When his cowl is off, it looks like he's just got greasy paint. Now, I'm sure if they actually did take his cowl off, he would have the big circles, because obviously they completely cake the eyes with black kind of eyeliner. Now, what I really like about this, though, when they're trying to make it come across like it is just smeared stuff, it's just more realistic. It's like, that doesn't look lame to just take the cowl off and still see that. So I really, really like that, and I really feel like it would be cool to just see a scene, for example, if Bruce is in the Batcave, he's either putting his stuff on in like a suit-up scene, however, it doesn't have to be that. It could be him taking it off and he's looking in the mirror, just wiping it, and Andy Serkis's Alfred is behind him and he's just talking to him while he's taking it off. That would be awesome. But all in all, I think it would just honestly be a big missed opportunity if we didn't get some kind of suit up scene. It doesn't have to be like a choink, putting the gauntlet on and then the belt on and then the cowl on. It could just be something really simple, just showing him getting his shit together, putting a bit of the makeup on or something. That would be awesome. So I figure I'm going to end this video on this question just because I love it so much. So Gavin says, I recently watched Seven, and the ending of that movie was the most riveting, intense scene I've ever watched. It's a freaking mad thing when you realize what that guy has done to Brad Pitt. Like, if you haven't seen Seven, watch it. So it's the most intense, riveting scene Gavin's ever seen. So how do you think Reeves could craft an ending that's even half as good as Seven? I think Riddler's mind games will all lead up to a grand finale, so what could it be? I mean, it's so hard for me to kind of answer what that grand finale could be, because I could write 1,000 ideas on a piece of paper to liken it to that other script, and I may never come up with what that very thing is that Riddler does in the movie. However, I do think it could pertain to that scene of wherever, you know, that interrogation scene takes place where Batman's like, what have you done? You could probably see where I'm going with this. It's like at that moment where in Seven, they finally have everything they thought they would need for this case to be cracked. They have the serial killer, but that was purely playing into the serial killer's game. Like, literally, he wanted to get caught. Riddler, as we see in the trailer, gets caught. It's undoubtedly a part of his plan. So when Batman smacks on the window, or whatever interrogation scene we're going to see, and it's like, what have you done? That will be that moment, as to what you're likening here, where Bruce realizes, like, I know you're not here for no reason. Like, you're not here for no reason. What have you done? What have you done? And that will probably be on the precipice of the movie, of finding out whatever that grand Seven, like, as you put it, riveting, intense reveal moment of a scene will be. As to what that is, though, it's just so hard to tell. I probably need some more time to think of what it could be. It could be something that is really catastrophic to Gotham, a certain target that is absolutely huge, and Batman is just so close to finding out what it could be, but he loses his temper and he's like, what have you done to Riddler? Because obviously Riddler is like, I've been trying to reach you. It's just like those letters to the Batman that were addressed at the mayor's death scene on Gil Coulson's bloody chest with a bomb strapped around his neck. He's been trying to reach him, as we know. But that moment of where he's like, what have you done? And likening it to a Seven-like moment. And that's clearly, at least to me, along this theory, as I aforementioned, at this precipice moment, like in the film, where Batman needs to know whatever he's done next could be that grand finale moment. But as to what it could be, who knows? It could be the Riddler's final act where, yes, he's been killing people of importance in Gotham, the Gotham elite, who have a foot, so to speak, dipping in the paddling pool of corruption, as I've mentioned in previous videos. This time it might be leagues beyond that. It could be a public display of terror that, you know, Batman needs to thwart. And if he doesn't, then, you know, it could be catastrophic, or it could be something even more mind-blowing, a twist that we haven't even seen coming. But yeah, I would love to speculate on that more, but I'd be just talking out my ass because I just genuinely don't know what it is. But this is what it's all about. Maybe we can revisit this question in the next video. Let me know what you guys think of Gavin's question here, likening it to that purely along the Seven, and to what Gavin's saying here, the Seven storyline, with perhaps it being on the precipice of what has he actually done? What could that thing be? And how Reeves could even craft an ending or a precipice of a moment in the movie that is even as half as good as that Seven ending. And if you've seen Seven, you know exactly what we're talking about here. It's like, if you've never seen it before and you're watching it and you see that ending, it's just like, Jesus Christ. Like, wow. Like, what? Wow. It's honestly like that. And if you haven't seen Seven, like, oh my god, just watch it and you'll see what I mean. And then you can take that into this movie of the Batman. And after Matt Reeves saying Seven is one of the inspirations, you can see why Gavin's getting at that. Because it's like, holy shit, what if the Batman pulls a similar stunt in the third act with none other than somebody perfect enough of an example than the Riddler, a guy who could pull a Seven-like serial killer Kevin Spacey move at the very final act of the movie. But anyway, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for watching this Batman video. It's been a blast, and I will be doing another one, hopefully next week, because now we are fresh out of, well, not so fresh, it was a little while ago now, but out of the main trailer for the Batman. There is still so much we can talk about. Beforehand, we had a whole year's worth of videos just based on the 25 to 35% of footage that Reeves had filmed just to make that first trailer. Now we've got a whole bunch more footage, so yeah. I hope you enjoy the future videos to come, guys. As I said, just make sure you leave your theories, thoughts, everything down in the comments below. I will try and get to each and every single one of yours over the course of time, of course. But if you are brand new here, I do encourage you to subscribe for more bonus videos like this, but also attached with news. Like, there will be news coverage on this channel. Like, if there's something of note to know about the Batman, you can be sure that I will be covering it. As always, guys, if you got this far in a video, put the hashtag to prove that you did, even though some people have pointed out other people could just copy it. But I'd like to think the audience is more genuine than that. Put along with whatever comment you're gonna put down there, just like what was said in the trailer, hashtag Riddler's the match. But other than that, everybody, I have links in the top pinned comment of that comment section where you can follow me on Twitter. It is just /BobaTalk. Same with my Facebook page. Yes, I have a Facebook page and also Instagram and Discord. There's a server invite link down there. But thank you so much for watching. I hope you all have a lovely rest of your day, and I'll see you, Bat family, in the next video. Goodbye.